What's up? Welcome to Startup X Podcast, powered by TeamCaliber.com. I'm your host, Six Sensei, and joining me today is Sean Zulu. You can follow us on Twitter. I'm at TooSickTV, and you're at
Sean Zulu. Don't forget the underscore. Sean underscore Zulu.
Are you done over-tweeting your tweets? Overstating your Twitter?
They gotta find me.
They will find you. And, you know, when they do find us, they have an opportunity at their hands. Why don't you tell them about the opportunity to win something here today?
We have a copy of Halo 4. And if you check out Sensei's channel, youtube.com/TooSickTV, you would have known that in the last podcast we did, we were giving away a copy of Halo 4 for the funniest comment about the DRM situation with the Xbox One.
So there was like zero comments for that, right?
Yeah.
So we want a tweet. Tweet at us.
Tweet at us. You know, find some kind of way to reach us and say something hilarious about this ridiculous DRM situation. And, you know, you might get sent a used, let's point that out, a used copy of Halo 4.
That's the awesome piece about it, is the used copy. So that's why we want the joke to be about the used game situation.
Right, because we don't like, people don't like new games, apparently. Like, new games are not a thing that people want in the next generation.
No, new.
Used.
The hell is new?
They want to buy a launch day used copies of Titanfall.
Is that possible? You know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to stand out there. I'm going to buy 100,000 of them, and I'm going to stand in front of GameStop and hand them out used. I'm going to sell them used for $5 more than what I paid.
You know,
for
it's
them.
Almost like the developers should have like old discs that they like refurbish, and it's like you can buy this for like $5 cheaper if you use this shitty, you know, older disc that they ripped a copy of Viva Pinata off of or something like that.
Oh, fucking Viva Pinata. So, more on Xbox. You know, this week, some of the original Xbox names for the OG Xbox, the original Xbox, some of the names that they were tossing around got revealed, got leaked, or whatever you want to call it. And it's kind of funny to look at this stuff and to think about, man, what if they went with one of these names? But what if this is where they went with this whole thing? Like, what would we be talking about today?
Is it as funny as them going with Xbox One for the second
Xbox,
the third Xbox console?
So now we have to say something like OG Xbox. We can't say the original Xbox.
It's like they just want to forget the original Xbox altogether.
And I don't see why they would want to do that. I mean, that was a solid console. It was the breaking point for them to get into the game.
Let's be honest. They really wanted to kind of reestablish, like just reinvent the Xbox brand and go Xbox One. But you had that moment at the press conference when they announced it where you were like, wait a sec, is that the new one?
Yeah.
Wait.
I was like, oh, okay, that's what they're going to call it. I was like, man, okay, that's what they're going to call it. And I wasn't exactly excited. At first, I don't know how my first reaction exactly was, but I was like, okay. I mean, it is what it is. There's not much I can do about it, but care. And, you know,
You'll forget about it. Like, how easily we forget. Like, that'll be something that, like, you'll just start calling it the Xbox. You won't even think about the one part after a while. It'll just be the Xbox.
That's like everybody says 360.
You know,
right?
Like,
now,
what it is, for a while after the initial launch, people will be like, the new Xbox.
Yeah.
You know, or they'll say Xbox One, but for the most part, people will be like, no, on the new Xbox. And then eventually, you know, as it, you know, just goes farther and farther into this gen, you'll just say the Xbox.
I mean, people have essentially forgot about Xbox One anyway, like the original Xbox anyway. See, I just made the fucking mistake.
People have essentially
forgot about that console in essence anyhow.
Well,
so from a marketing standpoint, like, it doesn't really matter. They say Xbox One. Obviously, nobody's making games for the OG Xbox.
But
so
that's between people like us. We talked about
that
bubble.
We live in that bubble.
Yeah, the bubble.
You know, but for most people, it doesn't matter whatsoever, you know, for the Xbox name. And, you know, it doesn't matter to me either at the same time. Like, I could give two shits
about what the name is. So why didn't they just call it the Xbox?
They could have named it the VCR. That's what it looks like anyway, right?
It does look like
I gotta wonder, though. I gotta wonder. Maybe you guys can tweet at us. Why do we care so much about what the box looks like? Do you care, Sean?
No, truthfully, my 360 is behind my TV right now. I never even see it.
I mean, I guess I kind of care. Like, maybe a 10% of me cares what the box looks like. Because I care what it does more than I give a shit what it looks like.
If it was atrocious, like you just were embarrassed to, you know, tell your girlfriend, like, hey, this is a new Xbox and it looks like horrible, that would be different. But this isn't that bad. I mean,
you know what, though? When I stop and think about it, when you said that, girlfriend, it brought me out of my bubble. The bubble that we talk about. And I was thinking...
Is that because you're married?
It's because I'm married. It brought me out of that bubble because And I thought about, what about those people who are actually interested in all the TV aspects of the Xbox One? What about those people? They will be placing it on their entertainment center. It will be, you know, in Xbox's eyes or Microsoft's eyes, it will be a focal point of their hub, you know, and it, the look of it will matter to them.
That, well, I don't think it looks bad. Like, you know, I'm not a console designer,
really,
but I don't think it looks bad, and I don't think it's enough to say it's so ugly I just won't buy that. It's a black box, dude. It's a black box. It's, you know, the PlayStation.
How does that look? I was just about to ask you. How does it compare?
I think it looks better. I think it looks a little bit slimmer, a little bit sleeker, and it's really got that, what is that, like a parallelogram kind of.
You didn't take geometry, did you?
Not, I wasn't good at it.
I don't know what that shape is, but it's
It looks cool though. It does. It and like I even seen on they had it on TV somewhere. It was it has like a illuminated blue line in the middle, I think.
That's kind of sexy.
Yeah, it is kind of sexy.
Yeah. I mean,
it beat it. It beat it on the aesthetics of the box.
Yeah. I would definitely say, in my opinion, you know, the PlayStation looks better. And it's probably going to perform better as a you know, a PC type of situation. You know, its internals are going to perform better. That's already generally been proven.
As of now, but did you hear about that they might be changing the internals of the Xbox One?
I didn't hear about that. I heard about the guy who tweeted out and said basically,
I don't know if it's true or not.
It doesn't. Basically said it doesn't matter what's in the box. He said he heard the same argument last generation and it didn't matter. The games are awesome. The box is awesome. That's what matters. And I have to agree with you. I mean, if especially with this cloud situation, that's going to make a big difference. Because the cloud being available, sure, it's still available, and that's great. But the problem is the developers won't have an opportunity to use it. Or even if they do take the opportunity to use it, they're limiting their audience right out of the gate. Because how many Xboxes aren't online? You know what I mean? And that's going to drive developers to not make things to use the cloud. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because they're limiting their audience. And why would you build something to limit your audience? It's just like Kinect, right? Kinect 1. Kinect is pretty damn powerful. I don't want to say powerful, but it's inventive. And it could work in creative ways if you worked it right. And the next one could definitely do that. And they're forcing everybody to have it plugged in. I think
How do you feel about this generation's Kinect? This be the first Kinect.
I feel like they fleshed it out as much as they could have for what they did with it. I really feel like Microsoft did a good job with it. And I'm not being an apologist. I think most of the games are fucking shovelware. I think most of it kind of sucks. But for in general, you know, for the party games, for the dance games, for the things that it, in my mind, is created for, it won't matter. So,
do you remember the first Kinect's tech demo, like before, you know, when it was being announced and released and shown what it could do, the first one?
I remember pieces about it.
Okay. I think what people forget is that this new Kinect, it looks awesome. That tech demo, I mean, even if you don't like Kinect and you don't want to do things, it looked awesome. But people forget that if you compare them, that's what I would like to see. Maybe if we could find a video of them comparing the original Kinect's tech demo next to the new Kinect 2.0's tech demo, I think you would be like, This is the same shit. Like, they're promising the same shit over again.
I don't think so. I think this tech demo has a lot to offer.
Not specifically, but like, it's kind of like the same pitch. They're just throwing it back at you.
You know? But the key is, here's the key, is that every Xbox sold will have one. So every developer out there has a reason to use it, which means all those creative minds who make the things that we love and care about will have a reason to use it. And then they'll be like better with Kinect and, you know, right now there's only 8, 9, maybe 10 million Kinects out there. There's 70, 80 million Xboxes. Why build a game just for Kinect or put any effort or development time into Kinect 1 when you're limiting your audience? That's what I'm talking about with the cloud. If every console doesn't have the cloud, developers aren't going to use it as much as they could, or they're not going to put as much resources into it. Because not everybody's using the cloud. Not everybody even has access to the cloud.
Which is why I think the reversal of the DRM policy stomped all over the cloud situation in a major way. But going back to the Kinect, you know, obviously these people who create video games are super creative, super intelligent people when it comes to this stuff. And yeah, they'll have a Kinect in every box and they'll know, okay, he bought an Xbox One, he's got a Kinect.
Yeah.
But let's do an experiment right now. Use your creative brain. What are they going to use this everybody has a Kinect situation for? Like, the thing you can think that's most practical right now.
Well, right now, the Kinect 1 has a lot of limitations. I have mine sitting right here on this desk.
Right.
It can't see me. Basically, it's here because it's a microphone. And that is it. It can't see me because of its limitations. It doesn't have that... I have to be kind of sitting...
Right, you gotta get in frame,
a little bit further away.
Yeah, yeah.
This new Xbox has a better depth of field. So that's gonna increase its availability of use, especially for someone like me. Not to mention, it's smarter. The program is smarter, so it's gonna be able to use people sitting down.
But
that's
technical.
The biggest thing.
That's a technical thing, like, okay, it's a little bit better in concept now.
Yeah,
but like
yeah.
I'm saying, using your creative brain, like what are they gonna do when you have a Kinect? Like what's that thing? What's that killer thing that they're gonna do where it's like, oh shit, I'm glad this came with a Kinect.
I really don't think there is a killer thing that they're gonna do that's like the system seller.
Not to say that these intelligent creative dudes that make video games who do things like it's way harder to make a video game than we can fathom.
Ever imagine.
But you know, so they'll figure out some cool shit eventually. Oh, yeah. But I'm saying just as an experiment, think about What are they going to do? Like, what's going to be that thing that's like, oh, okay, yeah, I'm glad that, you know, I got to connect with this.
And on that point, I'd like to hear some of our audience's ideas and thoughts. What do they think about that situation? You make sure you tweet at us. But, you know, I really don't know that this is a system seller as far as that goes. But on the same side of that, you know, the Minority Report stuff that happens, that's kind of what it's about. You know what I mean?
It's amazing. And people, all we need is like
people two, hate on it.
Yeah, all we need is like two, you know, two twins in a hot tub with whatever they were. What were they? Psychic twins?
Yeah.
I didn't see any of that in the tech demo for Kinect 2. So I was like, this shit is trash.
Yeah. So anyway, I was trying to break into the Xbox One names. And I was trying to think about where would we be today if they didn't go with Xbox? Yeah, so first of all, I think Xbox kind of sounds cool, especially compared to some of the names I have on this page here.
Yeah, but what if Xbox... you know, wasn't the name, and they called it one of those stupid things.
That's the question. So one of them is Max, Microsoft Action Experience.
Yeah, I read through all of them, and it was, it just hurts my head. It hurts my head. Well, Ayo. Think about this, though. This is a bunch of names from the original Xbox, and this is before Microsoft was ever a gaming company.
Yeah, I get that part.
So it's,
I get that
they
part.
Didn't know the hardcore audience. They weren't really embedded in the gaming culture, and it was a much different world. How long ago was that? You think about those concepts coming up. When the original Xbox came out?
99?
I don't know. If I say something, I would most definitely be wrong. Let's say
something
around
like that. Yeah.
Dude, that's a whole different world. That's an entirely different world.
Completely different world. But on the same side of that, I mean, they come out with Xbox. It's not an acronym. Almost everything on this page is an acronym. So you think about that. I got maybe 20, 25 things
here. So apparently in 1999, acronyms were the shit. Did you even have internet
in
1999?
Everything had to have an X. No, I didn't. Everything had to have an X in 1999.
You just watched a lot of Will Smith movies?
Extreme everything. A lot of Will Smith movies. I mean, I got some of the names here. You got RPM, Real Performance Machine.
It's terrible.
I mean, that's kind of cool for like a car guy.
Yeah, but it seems like this story is, well, no, actually, you know what? I heard that this story was disclosed by a guy that works for Xbox now, and he worked on all the consoles, including the original one, and he gave that list out. He released it.
I just got to ask, like, it's just so weird.
Because I was going to say that maybe the media found this or got a hold of it and just played it up. But
no, it was released. I mean, why not release it?
I'm sure there's terrible names for everything that you ever have that's cool now.
It's fun to look at them.
Yeah, it's...
It's fun to look at them and hear about them. You got MTG, Microsoft Total Gaming.
Oh, man.
You got MOX, MOX.
MOX.
Microsoft Optimal Experience.
The hell?
Lex, Live Entertainment Experience.
Why are they so acronym heavy?
I don't know.
Wait, is the acronym when they use each letter?
Yeah,
is that right?
Yeah.
I feel like that's wrong.
An acronym. That's what that is.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
All right.
So anyway, you got TAC, you got TAC.
TAC.
Total Action Center.
Total Action. Are they going to get like Arnold Schwarzenegger? Total Action Center.
VPS, Virtual Play System. It's just so generic.
Yeah, that sounds generic.
But allegedly, these are the names that were, like, considered. This isn't like the B list. This is like, these are the names we're putting up on the whiteboard which one are, you know, we're sitting around a table, which one are we going to go with?
Well, do you know why they ended up calling it Xbox?
I have no idea.
It's because when they were creating it, you know, this is the first Xbox, not, you know, this, so this is way
back.
The OG
Xbox.
So imagine, I don't know how long it takes them to create this first console, but I'd imagine it's a number of years. And when the employees who were working on it, the engineers were emailing back and forth, that's what they called it. That was like their internal own code name.
Yeah.
And they would say, you know, the Xbox. And it just eventually caught on, and they were saying it back and forth so much to each other before anybody ever knew what the system was that they got, you know, it got through and they were like, let's call it the Xbox. Like, why, who are we kidding?
You're saying that was like a generic term that they used. Yeah, it was a box.
It was between the engineers and the people creating it. It wasn't even like one of these code names like Durango or, you know, whatever they call them, something stupid. So it was, yeah. Yeah, but that's how that happened, man. That was completely between the engineers. Like, they came up with that in their, you know, corresponding back and forth about the console. That was just their pet name for it. Xbox.
That's cool to think about.
That's a true story, too. That's pretty
fun.
Cool.
That's fun to think about because, you know, even though they had all these whack-ass names on there.
Yeah, that's terrible. But you know what else that says, though, is don't overcomplicate things, man. Like
sometimes they
called it
important.
Xbox, and they were like, "Look, that's, you know, we call it that. We feel comfortable calling it that. We think people will too."
I like it.
I would imagine that the guys who work on the console are, you know, so far removed from the guys who name the console in that big of a corporation that might have been kind of hard for these engineers to say, "Call it the Xbox. Like, we built it. Call it the Xbox." You know, so. That brings up another point, you know, now that I'm thinking about that. Did you hear about the restructuring of Microsoft's business, you know, their whole
corporation? I did hear about the restructuring. So it's interesting to me to think about this. So I know today seems like a really Xbox-centric thing, but they're the only people in the news, right? News is silent. News is nothing. PlayStation, they're like, they walked up for a month or so. They won, dropped the mic, and walked out. Now they're like radio silence almost.
Well, you know what the PlayStation, you know, all the people that work for PlayStation are doing right now are just smiling ear to ear. They're celebrating. They're having big, expensive corporate dinners. Everybody's getting raises.
Yeah. They're watching Microsoft just keep making all this news and the headlines.
What are the pre-order numbers even to this day on two of them?
Allegedly, everybody's pretty much sold out. So if you haven't pre-ordered yours, you better find a way to do it.
No, what I mean is...
I mean everybody.
The PlayStation is... killing it, right? In terms of pre-orders, right?
I have no idea. Allegedly, yes. I mean, I don't know numbers.
For the sake of this goddamn conversation, let's say
they are. Yes, I think so. and rightfully so, in my opinion. You know, they've done it right as far as the PR situation goes. They've done it right. They win. They win all from E3, from February, all the way up until today. They're still winning because Microsoft keeps making these decisions. Like you said, they're diversifying their company. That's a mistake that Sony has been dealing with for the past, I don't know, since PlayStation 3 launched. They've been dealing with that problem because they were always segregated. So one hand couldn't talk to the other, and it was always a problem to make something happen. You know, they never had, you know, kind of a tight-knit company. So now their new head of the company has kind of pulled everybody together. He's putting, you know, he's diminishing the company, not the company in a way, but he's bringing them together more family-like.
But as, you know, just as a gamer, not necessarily an Xbox fan or a PlayStation fan, how do you think now about this Xbox console? Because it's clearly there's some trouble here. They went back on their DRM situation, which, you know, like I said, we don't create consoles, but obviously it's not an easy thing to change all the architecture of the system and just completely go back on what you've been working on for however many years they've been working on this thing.
That's not possible.
And then their one of their lead guys, his name escapes me right now. What's his name?
Don Matrick.
Leaves and goes to Zynga. Which, by the way, I read something about that, and apparently that wasn't really because of this recent Xbox situation.
It could be fake.
I'm not, you know, I'm just saying.
I'm going to go with it then. It's because.
But they said that he's been meaning to leave for quite a while now, and this was kind of just like, you know, this was perfect opportunity, and he just left because he apparently tried to buy Zynga on behalf of Microsoft so they could get into that social media thing when it was really, really hot, and it everything fell apart. And so in that process, he became really good friends with the lead guy at Zynga or one of the owners or some shit like that.
So he went to work over there?
Right now?
Yeah.
Yeah, he went as the CEO over there.
I just,
So apparently, what I'm saying is that's not a symptom of the Xbox having to reverse their policy and basically, you know, looking like a bunch of asses. But it's just something that's been in the works for a while. But
it's hard for me to look like it's not. It's hard for me to look at it like it's not a situation.
It's definitely something that was, you know, spawned from this whole Xbox 180 situation.
I think he rolled out. I mean, he was probably thinking about it. It might have been on
the
mind.
Well, he had to have contacted these people and known them in some kind of way. It's not like he just said, hey, man, I left Xbox, you know, can I got a job over there? Yeah, come on over. Like, no. But it's from this 180 thing.
Yeah, it's got to be. I mean, that had to be the straw that broke the camel's back. I mean, maybe he had his resume out there. Maybe he was thinking about, hey, Zynga, maybe I'll come work with you guys.
No, I think it's more he didn't want the rabid fan base of Xbox to hate him.
I was just about to say that. Can you imagine the backlash of the internet? Those people, I mean, internet anonymity is just brutal. It's brutal, man. People say the most... They say some shit you just can't even repeat.
You sound like you speak from experience, good sir.
I don't say that stuff. I mean, I read it, though, sometimes.
No, I'm talking about it coming at you.
Oh, every once in a while. It's very minimal, though. Very minimal. People don't.
But anyway,
I need a little bit of that hate. I need some.
Yeah, get you some.
Tweet
get
at me.
Some.
I need some. Yeah. Tweet at me some hate. Please. Like, Sensei, you suck, dog. You can't snipe. Or
send
shit.
At Too Sick TV some hateful tweets right now. Your phone is in your pocket.
Your phone's in your pocket. You might be listening to this on your phone because we are, as a little bit of a news, we're on iTunes.
Yeah.
For the first time that we're recording a podcast with the intentions of going on iTunes. We're on iTunes and we're also partnered up with Team Caliber.
Yeah, so, which is something I want to ask you about because I use the Twitter. You know, I look at it frequently. I tweet. I do all the things you might do on Twitter. And today I'm noticing some hashtag TK, you know, really causing a frenzy here. And me and you spoke a little bit about it. And I want you to tell me a tiny bit about it.
So
tell me some
huge,
more about it. You know,
this is huge news for me, for the community. I mean, and I genuinely feel that way, right? Like, I'm not hyping it up. To be anything more than what I truly think that it is and can be.
Uh-huh.
You know, Team Caliber is being put together by Chaos Silencer.
Who is a pretty big YouTuber.
Yeah, he's big YouTuber. He's community manager for Yaush. He's got some really awesome connections and some awesome friends in the right places.
Right.
That not only can drive Team Caliber, even if, in my opinion, even without, you know, the huge following that he already has and the friends in place. Like, I think that Team Caliber can grow into something that's bigger just because of what we're doing, right? So we're doing sniping division, knifing division, which is something new.
So this is like different entities within Team Caliber. This is
correct.
Like what they will offer.
Absolutely correct. It's so sniping, knifing, war beasting, which is kind of our version of pub stomping. So like 100 plus games. 180 plus games.
Just animals. Just
like triple nukes and shit like that.
No
just
specification, just killers.
That's
huh?
right. And we got the editing division, which is a bunch of editors who are just freaking amazing. We got some amazing guys on board, and we're going to be getting even more. And then we got the MLG division, which we can't talk about now. But as soon as it comes out, man, I know people are going to be stoked. People who know that scene, people who are into that scene, when they see the people that are coming up, it's going to be pretty intense. We're trying to get into MLG Columbus, which is another big event for MLG. Call of Duty. Everything's Call of Duty based, obviously. I didn't say that, but I'd like to say that. Everything's Call of Duty based, but the biggest thing is the professionalism. In my opinion, the biggest thing is the professionalism. I never joined a team. I'm sure I could have joined a couple teams. There was a couple teams asking me to join. I'm not going to throw names around, but, and I just never felt like there was a home for me.
Right.
Because I'm not essentially a feeder. Like, I don't go feeding all day.
Well, you don't want that classic clan experience.
I don't want that classic clan. Like, I watch these guys. I'll see some Envy guys. Envy's a great clan. They're a fantastic clan. But those guys don't get the representation that they deserve, in my opinion. Because, you know, and the way I think that, the reason I think that way is because I go to their personal channel. That they upload consistent content, and they do, and they got like 300 subs.
Well, you know,
is
when
that
I look
nightmare?
At the, that's
you're part
a nightmare.
Of Team. I mean, you're part of Envy, which is absolutely huge in the sniping community. Zergriz is an owner of Envy, and for some reason, they can't. I mean, their personal channels aren't getting the representation that I personally feel like they deserve, and that's what this whole Team Caliber is about. Is like driving the content to the channels. And one of the other biggest things, back to the professionalism piece, is that you know, all the content is going to be on one channel. It's going to be subdivided on that channel and playlist.
That's awesome.
But the unity is important because we're all going to be there. It's not going to be a sniping channel and a knifing channel.
Well, that's awesome, because now these YouTube users, they subscribe one channel, one you time, get all the content.
All the amazing
and
content.
Something that's beautiful that, you know, me and you talked about was the Team Caliber. They have every aspect of creating great YouTube content all in that one spot.
Especially for Call of Duty. Yeah.
But I'm sure, you know, this thing's going to grow. It looks like y'all are working on something big. I checked out the website. What's the website?
TeamCaliber.com. TeamCaliber. Caliber with a K. K-A-L-I-B-E-R.
Right.
.com. We got a Spreadshirt shop up, which is going to be, that's going to be filled out with hats and all kinds of awesome merchandise. The official roster's up there, and that thing's going to continue to grow with some amazing players. We got the recruitment challenges coming out soon. Like, it's just one thing after another. And for me, having a full-time job and a baby and, you know, it's kind of overwhelming. And now we're doing the podcast stuff. So it's really going to be a balance of my life trying to get this stuff together, but it's going to be awesome. And I'm excited to be a part of it. I really am. I'm so thankful to, you know, Chaos and the rest of the guys for looking at my stuff and saying, hey, you know, I think you got a home here.
I think it's a beautiful idea, man, because when you think about the internet and the abundance of content that gets thrown out there,
it's insane.
It's like, where do I put my time here? And then you got, you know, you guys put together something like this that's like, look, we're going to have quality stuff in whatever aspect of Call of Duty you're looking to check out, you know?
That's right. Most clans don't have, like, full gameplays from snipers. You won't really catch much of that from FaZe or Optic. I'm not hating on those clans. They're really fantastic content creators. But they're kind of contributing to the flood, in my opinion. Now, we're going to do that. We're going to create some amazing montages, some amazing team tages. And then we also got ultimate team tages, which is going to encompass every division. So you're going to have knifing clips, war beasting clips, sniping clips, all in the same montage.
That's going to be too much fun, man.
It's going to, you're just going to sit back. And then the editors, man, you got to see some of the stuff these guys are capable of. Some serious, serious editing. I mean, if you just look at the promo video, you'll know. These guys ain't fucking around.
I enjoyed the shit out of the promo video. Where can people find the promo video?
You can find it at TeamCaliber.com.
Cool.
So anyway, I mean, that's just an exciting aspect. And again, this podcast is powered by Team Caliber. Not only that, but we will be doing Skype conversations on here with some of the members. Just so, you know, the ultimate fan of Team Caliber can get to know their guys a little bit better.
Right.
You know? It's all about, to me, you know, and I'm sure you feel this way, too. When you're a fan of somebody and what they do, wouldn't you like to feel like you get to know them on a personal level?
Yeah.
I mean, I love podcasts.
Not like in a creepy way, but just a little bit. Yeah, you know definitely. What I mean? You want them to appreciate the fact that you appreciate what they're doing.
That's right.
You know?
That's right. And it's like we talked a little bit about it earlier. You know, I listen to Podcast Beyond and some of the IGN podcasts.
Oh, yeah.
And it's almost like, not in a creepy way, not in a weird way, or you know, but it almost feels like, you know, you're there with them. You're friends with them. You're just BSing with them. At least in your own mind, you get vested in the conversation. You feel like you can almost talk to them.
I mean, you get to know those guys way more
through a podcast
than anything you could imagine.
That's right. That's right. And that's why I wanted to do this. That's why I enjoy doing this, because number one, I get to sit down, drink a couple beers. By the way, beer me. Sit down, drink a couple beers.
Roger that.
with a friend and, you know, have some fun, man. You know, talk about games. This is what we're passionate about.
Well, for fans of the of this podcast that have been listening, you know, long before this turned into an audio thing, why don't you tell us a little bit about who you're going to have on here and if we're going to see Sick Lawless and Psycho come back.
Oh, you're turning this into an interview, huh, buddy? This is not an interview. This is a casual conversation. This is a conversational podcast.
What does Greg Miller say on
this podcast? This is a
conversational podcast.
We're definitely going to see Lawless. I definitely want to get the old crew back, just at least once or twice here and there. You know what I mean?
You got to, man. And if you know, the just people listening answer. To this don't know what we're talking about right now, you've got to go to Sensei's YouTube channel.
YouTube.com/2SickTV.
Find the Startup X playlist and just go skim through some of them episodes.
There's 39 episodes.
I think
don't go to the beginning. They're pretty bad.
Go to the beginning. Go right to the beginning. No, but go, you know, I know you don't have time probably in your day to just waste 4 hours listening to a bunch of podcasts, but go skim through some of them. I think if you're a gamer, you'll find some stuff you really enjoy.
We did 38 episodes with the three of us, and I mean, dude, it was just a blast. That's why we want to reboot this.
Yeah.
That's why we want to have some fun with it. And, And I'm glad you brought this setup, dude, because I think it sounds amazing. Hopefully it comes through. Hopefully there's no bugs. This is the first one we're doing with the intentions of audio only.
Well, this is a goal here, you know, and hopefully by the time you hear this, it'll be a reality. But this will be available on iTunes and Stitcher. So we're going to make it as easy as possible.
And an RSS feed at SeanZulu.com.
We'll release the page for that, you know, as we get further along here. But all right. No, it'll be iTunes and Stitcher. We'll make it as easy as possible for you to get this thing. And, you know, that you know we're going to have
some fun. We'll tweet out the links to it. So follow us. I'm at 2SickTV. That's the number 2, SIKTV. And you're at Sean, SEAN underscore Zulu. Do we have any other news? Any other pieces of points we want to talk about, buddy?
Well, I mean, there's not really that much happening in the gaming world. It's kind of like that shockwave hit us, and then it's like the you know.
It's the recess of the shockwave.
Yeah, yeah.
We're waiting for the other big jump of news to come back around. Yeah, it's
coming, right though.
The biggest news for me and for the Call of Duty community is Team Caliber. I mean, in my opinion, again, you know, it's some pretty amazing stuff about to go down and already going down in the works, in the processes.
One of the reasons we're getting this together is, you know, because this next gen is going to hit and we want this thing to be up and running.
Yeah, definitely.
When the next gen hits and, the Team Caliber news is brand new, but that's going to be awesome that y'all are getting that together before this next gen hits. And
it's another idea. That's why,
you know what else is beautiful about the Team Caliber thing that just hit me is you think about. Everybody is going to have the capability to upload and stream and do all of this shit that, you know, people are doing right now to publish content. Now, with somebody like Team Caliber or any of these other people out here are putting together a good crew of people, now you're going to be like, I'm inundated with all this bullshit content from this dude with his one Xbox One over here. No, I'm going to spend 15 minutes, 20 minutes going checking out some dudes do it the right way, you know.
That's right, yeah.
You find a channel like Team Caliber. I think that's beautiful.
I think it's awesome.
Perfect timing, my friend.
I was just about to say, I think we're getting out there at the right time to do it, and it's going to be exciting, man. Hopefully I can get Chaos Silencer on here. We'll do one. He told me we could do one in a couple of days, so that'd be awesome.
You know, because, you know, it's like let me speak from the outside a little bit, is I've turned into somebody that's, I'd much rather watch Call of Duty content than I'd rather play Call of Duty. You know, I kind of tapped out of the really logging hours into Call of Duty. And I just like to go on YouTube and check out, you know, some, you know, what's kind of happening in the world of Call of Duty every now and then.
Yeah.
And like for me, you know, or just somebody like me, because I'm not the only one.
Yeah, I'm sure.
For somebody to be able to have the opportunity to go, hey, man, I'm going to go check out Team Caliber. Or, you know, who else is big out there?
Optic Phase,
you know, White Boy, your channel, you know, so it makes it, you know.
Woody.
It's a beautiful
today.
Thing, man. I think y'all, it's an evolving thing, and y'all turn that into something really cool.
Yeah, again, I'm excited about it. I mean, I really am. You know, speaking on that tapping out of Call of Duty thing, you know, I wanted to go back. By the way,
I played Modern Warfare 2 for the first time, and I don't know how long the other day. Still holds up, dude.
Oh, yeah.
Modern Warfare 2.
The connection's so damn good in that game.
Wow.
Like, the hit detection's just fucking solid. If you shoot somebody, they're going to take a bullet.
Yeah.
Black Ops 2, you got to shoot 3 bullets straight at them, and maybe the third, maybe the fourth one might connect.
Dude, I think Modern Warfare 2 is the best entry in the Call of Duty multiplayer thus far.
Let's not do that.
Me personally, I'm not speaking for anybody else but myself, but it holds up, dude. If you go play it,
it had some problems.
It holds up.
It had some problems. But anyway, what I was talking about is that tapping out of Call of Duty thing. You talked about tapping out, and you talked about, you know, and I was thinking about how a lot of people, you know, probably tap out of Call of Duty at some point. Which brings me back to a point that we brought up last week was Titanfall. You know, these guys are not taking the Battlefield route. They're not trying to go up against Call of Duty. They know better. They built Call of Duty. They built Call of Duty into what it is today.
Yeah, buddy.
So, that being said, they're going up in spring. A lot of when you're definitely going to be tapped out of Ghost. You're going to play Ghost, I'm sure.
I'm gonna check it out. I mean,
you're gonna be tapped out probably long before then.
Unless there's budget issues, but I'll check out.
You may be tapped out of Battlefield by that point.
I like the campaigns in Call of Duty. Like, I know I sound. People are probably like, "This motherfucker with his campaign playing that." But I enjoy the shit out of it. It's like a big action movie. It's cheesy. It's great, man.
I haven't even played Black Ops 2 single player.
Well, you know,
ever
when you're sniping like you snipe.
I never played Modern Warfare 3 either.
I didn't either.
Modern Warfare 3. Only reason I played Black Ops is because back when I was a PlayStation only guy, PlayStation Network went down when Black Ops 1 was out, and I was like, well, fuck, I gotta do something.
Yeah.
You know, I'm bored out of my mind over here. So anyway, guys, I think that's pretty much a podcast. I think that's an episode 40. Thank you guys for joining us. I'm Six Sensei.
I'm Sean Zulu.
And we're out. Peace.